Aloha. Welcome to lecture 5, where we're going to talk about the third week of development. The first thing we're going to talk about is gastrulation. And if we want to talk about gastrulation, I suppose the first thing that we have to do is talk about what gastrulation is. So to put it very simply, gastrulation is the process of converting a bilaminar embryonic disc into a trilaminar embryonic disc. All right, so here we have two layers, the epiblast and the hypoblast. And by the time we get to over here, we're going to have three layers. And then, of course, once something changes, we know that everything's going to change to different names. So once we have three layers, now instead of having an epiblast and a hypoblast, we have an ectoderm, a mesoderm, and an endoderm. So ectoderm meaning outside, mesoderm meaning in between, and endoderm meaning inside. Right, so that's what we're gonna end up with. Now let's talk about how this happens, okay? Uh-oh. There we go. So the first thing that starts to happen is the epiblast cells are going to start proliferating. And as they begin proliferating, there's going to be a thickening of the epiblast cells. This thickening is called the primitive streak. At the same time that the primitive streak is forming, you're going to form this other structure over here called the prechordal plate. And this is significant because this is the first time that we're able to tell which is the head side and which is the rear side, right? So we have now a cranial and a caudal and a right and a left, whereas before all we had was dorsal and ventral. Now we're able to tell, okay, this is the cranial side, this is the caudal side, and this is the right side, and this is the left side. Okay. Now this primitive streak is going to form a membrane at the caudal end of the primitive streak, and that membrane is called the cloacal membrane, and this is eventually going to become the anus. It's going to eventually rupture and become the anus. The way the primitive streak becomes longer is by adding cells to the caudal end, so in effect, you have this embryo, and this primitive streak is going to get longer as the embryo grows in this direction, right? So the embryo is going to grow towards the caudal end. Is going to get longer, and that's going to make this primitive streak longer. At the center of the primitive streak, we start to form a groove. This groove is called the primitive groove. The primitive groove is in the center of the primitive streak. At the cranial end of the primitive streak, you start to form this kind of round node, this thickening of cells up in here, and this is called the primitive node. At the center of the primitive node, a structure forms called the primitive pit. So we've got the primitive streak and the primitive node with the primitive groove and the primitive pit. It's very primitive. Now, shortly after the primitive streak appears, the deep surface of the primitive streak begins to proliferate, and these cells begin to differentiate, and they differentiate into mesoderm cells. Now, the mesoderm layer is made up of mesoderm cells and loose connective tissue. This loose connective tissue is called mesenchyme, and mesenchyme is going to come up many, many, many times through this class. Mesenchyme basically gives rise, so mesoderm tissue gives rise to all the supporting tissues of the body, such as bone, cartilage, ligaments, tendons, et cetera, those kind of things, okay? Now, by the end of week 4, this primitive streak, and that's not till the next chapter, but this primitive streak by the end of week 4 is going to have done everything that it was meant to do, and it's going to stop doing anything. And what's going to happen then is the rest of the embryo is just going to completely outgrow it, leave it behind, and it's going to become this insignificant little speck that doesn't do anything anymore. What happens next is the mesenchyme of the primitive node begins to grow this process. And as this process grows out, it's called the nodochordal process, right? And it starts to extend from the primitive node cranially towards the prechordal plate. And we're going to take a look at this on the next slide because I like the way the next slide pictures it better. So you have this notochordal process, and this notochordal process extends out all the way until it bumps into the precordal plate. And as it bumps into the precordal plate, it's going to fold, right? You see how it starts to, and this is all accomplished by differential growth of the different layers of tissue, right? This gets thicker, this gets thicker, this gets thicker. And then this guy, and so basically what happens is you get these folds forming, and then these folds get pinched together so that you form this nice tube called the notochord. Now, interestingly, the notochordal process forms from caudal to cranial until it gets to the precordal plate. Once it gets to the precordal plate, the tube closes from cranial to caudal. So it starts to close from this end back towards this end. And as you can see here, it's about halfway done, right? And so anyway, as this thing closes, you end up with this structure called the notochord. Now the notochord forms the axis of the embryo. Eventually the spinal cord is going to form around this guy, and when it does that, the notochord is going to basically degenerate except for the bits of it that become the nucleus pulposus in the spinal discs. So something really important to remember about the notochord is that it is an inducer. It is a primary inducer of other tissues around it. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute, but first we're going to talk about this thing called the allantois. Okay? So allantois is this diverticulum or outpouching that comes of the, what's that thing called? The umbilical vesicle. On the caudal end of the umbilical vesicle, you start to see this outpouching called allantois. And this pouches out into the connecting stalk. This guy eventually is going to play a pretty major role in the formation of blood. It's also going to play a role in the formation of the urinary bladder, and the blood vessels around this allantois are eventually going to become the arteries and veins of the umbilicus, right? The umbilical arteries and veins. Okay. Let's see. So some of these primitive node cells that we talked about aren't going to form mesenchyme or mesoderm. Some of them are going to migrate out to the side and up. Now, on the picture, the arrow stops here, and I don't like that because that's not actually where it goes. It actually goes up and around all the way to the front of the precordal plate from both sides. These guys are going to meet in the middle up here in front of the precordal plate, and they're going to form an area called the cardiogenic area. These are going to differentiate into cardiac tissue, and they're going to begin to form the heart, which begins to develop at the end of the third week, okay? So as this notochord develops, it stimulates the ectoderm directly above it to thicken into what's called the neural plate. So this is called neurulation. Neurulation is really exciting to me because I'm a chiropractor, and chiropractors are all about affecting the nervous system, right? I love the nervous system. So the neural plate is eventually going to give rise to the central nervous system and really almost every part of the nervous system. So as this notochord forms, it induces the ectoderm tissue to differentiate and thicken into this neural plate. Okay, so it might happen on a quiz somewhere that you might want to know that the notochord is the primary inducer of neurulation. So let me just say that one more time in case you happen to see it on a quiz. The notochord is the primary inducer of neurulation, or the formation of the neural plate, which is eventually going to become the nervous system. So the neural plate begins to extend following the notochord all the way from the primitive node straight out to the precordal plate. Now, of course, once it gets to the precordal plate, what's going to happen? Well, the precordal plate is going to change names. It's going to become, instead of the precordal plate, the oropharyngeal membrane, which you can tell from the name, you can pretty well guess what that's going to have something to do with the formation of the mouth, right? So anyway, for now, the neural plate extends all the way to the prechordal plate. And once it reaches the prechordal plate, you start to see this groove form in the middle of it. This groove in the middle of the neural plate is called, guess what? The neural groove. Now, as the prechordal plate begins to thicken on either side of the neural groove, you start to see these structures called the neural folds, these thickenings in the prechordal or in the neural plate called neural folds, okay? And as we, let me see, make sure I didn't miss anything real quick. Oh, gosh. The neural plate and the neural folds. So let's move on to here. That was my daughter poking her head in here looking for my wife. Just in case you were wondering. So at any rate, as this groove forms, it's important to also know that as this neural folds and the neural groove begin to form, you see a differentiation of the ectoderm tissue. So you have surface ectoderm tissue now, and you also have neuroectoderm tissue, and they are, you know, they differentiate into two distinct types of tissue. So surface ectoderm, neural ectoderm. And then as these folds begin to peak up real high and this tube begins to close, you're going to see the formation of this crest of neural tissue. And this crest is called the neural crest. Now this neural crest is going to separate off. It's going to come together as the tube closes. It's going to come together and separate off. What's funny is that after the neural crest joins together, it's going to then separate into two halves again and migrate laterally. But at any rate, so this neural fold is eventually going to close together and form what's called the neural tube. Now, the neural tube is destined to become the brain and the spinal cord. These neural crest cells are going to migrate laterally, and they are going to become things like the spinal ganglion, the ganglion of the autonomic nervous system. They're going to become the sheaths of the peripheral nervous system. The inner layers of the meninges, the pia, and the arachnoid matter. They're also going to become the cranial nerve ganglia for cranial nerves 5, 7, and 9, and 10. And a lot of other neural structures are going to be formed from these guys. They're destined for greatness. But for now, we're just going to remember that we have the neural crest tissue out here laterally, the neural tube tissue in the middle, and now we have surface ectoderm, which is mostly going to become skin. Okay, and that is it for gastrulation and neurulation. If you have any questions, please write them down and bring them with you when you come to the Zoom meeting that we're going to have on Thursday. I love questions. I love clarifying things. And even more than that, I love it when you ask me a question that I don't know the answer to, because then I learn something. And if you stump me, it's an opportunity for people to get extra credit. So please, any questions at all, bring them with you, write them down so you don't forget them. And we'll see you on Thursday at the Zoom meeting. That's it for today. Aloha.